All right, folks. It's time to please stand up. I know it's hot, but we're here to rejoice. This is a happy day. It's a glorious day. It's the day the Lord has made. And if you know Jesus, then you're here this morning knowing that he washed your sins away and that he's filled us with rejoicing. Stand up and rejoice with us, please. My sins all the way. Oh, happy day. Oh, happy day. Oh, happy day. When Jesus washed.
Jesus.
Oh, when you washed.
When Jesus washed.
When Jesus washed. He washed my sins all the way. My sins all the way.
Oh, happy day.
Oh, happy day. Oh,
happy day.
Oh, happy day. Hallelujah.
Good morning. I hope you're all doing well today on this fine day. And this morning, as we sing how much of a happy day it is, I was thinking, again, this is the day the Lord has made, and we should rejoice and be glad in it.
Amen.
Able to be worshiping here together with our brothers and sisters in Christ, and together with all those around the world, in fact. And we've been examining the life of David recently, as he became the king of Israel, and all that he did. We're learning that many of the things in his life were shadows, and they were types, and they were showing what would come to be later in Jesus coming to fulfill them. And so I was reading through the chapter of Hebrews, and if you ever get a chance to read through the whole thing in one sitting, it's a really great overall picture of how God does this. He gives the types and the shadows, and then Jesus, the fulfillment. And it's a great encouragement for us as believers if we see how he did that. So for our call to worship this morning, and then later in our benediction, I'm going to read a little of, we'll call it the bookends of Hebrews, with a couple passages from the middle. And just listen how this flows. Long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom he also created the world. He is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature, and he upholds the universe by the word of his power. After making purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. And since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. And therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us, through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to the true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from the evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. So let us worship this mighty God who has done all these wonderful things for us this morning. Amen.
A couple of weeks ago, I was riding in my truck and I was listening to a message by Charles Stanley, a very encouraging message. Basically, the title of his message was, Obey God and Let Him Take Care of the Consequences. And there's so many applications for that, whether it be in a relationship that we're having and we know God's will for our life, or at our job, or just tons and tons of applications for obeying God and let him take care of the consequences. But in order to obey God, we really have to trust God. And God is so trustworthy, we can take him at his word, just like Abraham took him at his word, and it worked out for his good. So if we obey God and let him take care of the consequences, he'll make it happen. He'll make a way.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of his word, what a glory he sheds on our way. While we do his good will, he abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Not a burden sorrow we share, but our toil he doth richly repay. Not a grief nor a loss, not a frown nor a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey.
You may be seated.
Good morning. As a backdrop to Pastor Wayne's message this morning, we'll be reading Psalm 51, David's confession of his sin. And the superscript above the psalm says, "To the choir master, a psalm of David, when Nathan the prophet went to him after he had gone in to Bathsheba." And it says, "Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you only, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, you delight in truth in the inward being, and you teach me wisdom in the secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me with a willing spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God of my salvation, and my tongue will sing aloud of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise, for you will not delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You will not be pleased with a burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. Do good to Zion in your good pleasure. Build up the walls of Jerusalem. Then will you delight in right sacrifices, in burnt offerings and whole burnt offerings. Then bulls will be offered on your altar." Let's pray. Sovereign Lord, creator of all, David was a great sinner, and yet it is also said of him that he was a man after your own heart, and that he does all your will. Lord, this is great encouragement for us. We are sinners too. Lord, may it be said one day of every man and woman and child at Cornerstone that we were men and women and children after your own heart, and that we did all your will, and that in the words of Christ, we were found among those who worshiped in spirit and in truth. Thank you, Lord God, for the preaching of your holy word this morning. Thank you for the beautiful day. Please be with Pastor Wayne as he brings forth the message that you have for us. And Lord, help us to receive it in the spirit and to be doers of the word. Amen.
Amen. It is John Deere time. Want to wish our condolences to Dana Watson and family for the passing away of his mother, Alvine, this past week. There's a viewing Monday night from 6 to 7 at Plummer Funeral Home in Augusta, and then just a private family service at the graveside on Tuesday. And also, happy birthday to Levi Shepherd, 1 year old today. I think that's worth mentioning. And a little while ago, he was out front there worshiping while we were singing that first song. And hopefully we get a picture of that we can put on the end of this service. So we're in 2 Samuel chapter 12 today. I'm going to get right into it. I know it's warm out there, and feel free to kind of keep moving with the shade. Wherever it goes, you go, be comfortable. And pray the Lord will give a little breeze here as well today. The title of the message today is God's Jedidiah. And the main theme and doctrine will be that God extends loving grace to repentant fallen sinners, which we all are at different times to different degrees. After Garrett's great sermon last week on the last chapter, the fall of David, after David repented of his sin, after he was told the consequences of his sin, after the death of the baby that Bathsheba was carrying, his baby, we read in verse 24 and 25, then David comforted Bathsheba, his wife, and went into her and lay with her. So she bore a son, and he called his name Solomon, meaning peaceful. Now the Lord loved him, and he sent word by the hand of Nathan the prophet. So David called the name of this son Jedidiah because of the Lord. Jedidiah means loved by the Lord. We're going to just kind of go through this chapter today. If you give it a tap with an outline hammer, it'll break into six really neat pieces. We'll look at the confrontation with Nathan in the first 9 verses. Then the consequences for David of his sin, verses 10 through 12, 14 through 23. Then most importantly, the confession of David in verse 13. Then the comfort of God in 24 and 25. The conquest of Rabbah, verses 26 through 30. And then we'll have 3 concluding lessons. So first of all, the confrontation here with Nathan. 2 Samuel chapter 11 is a turning point in the life of David. He crashes, our hero falls, and his integrity is tarnished, and he never again quite attains to the greatness that he had before chapter 11. He was 49 years old when he committed adultery with Bathsheba and had her husband murdered, or set up to be murdered, in a battle, Uriah. And Uriah was no ordinary man. He's listed as one of David's 30 mighty men. In other words, of all the hundreds of thousands of soldiers in Israel, he was in the top 30. He was a commando. He was a Navy SEAL. And yet David basically had him put to death so that he could have Bathsheba and hide his sin of adultery. And the heinous thing about this is that if that was not enough, David thinks that he got away with it. He's making it look like after the death of Uriah that he comes in and rescues Bathsheba and marries her and takes care of the child she's carrying as if it was Uriah's child. I think I can make a case today that David broke not just sixth and seventh commandments, but that he broke all 10. The first commandment, that you are to have no other gods before me. And the God before Yahweh for David here was the God of lust. He saw Bathsheba bathing on her rooftop and lusted after her. The second command is that you're not to have any carved image or anything on heaven and earth or under the earth that you would bow down to or that you would serve. And David is serving the spiritual image, maybe you could say, of, again, a beautiful woman, of lust. The third commandment, you shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. And verse 14 says that because of David's sin, he's made the enemies of God to blaspheme the Lord. What a joker. This guy, David, supposed to be a holy king, leading Israel, following the law of God, and yet look what he's doing. The fourth commandment, keep holy the Sabbath. And I doubt there's a day or a Sabbath day after that sin that David ever really kept the Sabbath holy. How could he? With the hypocrisy and the unrepentant sin in his life. There were no psalms written during this entire year before Nathan confronts him after he commits the sin. There's no real fellowship or communion with God during that period. The fifth commandment, honor your father and mother. David certainly didn't honor the name, the family name, by the sins of adultery and murder. He was dragging the family name through the mud. His parents probably have been long dead, but nevertheless, the great reputation of Jesse and his family and his sons has been ruined by David's behavior. The sixth commandment, thou shalt not murder, Uriah. The seventh commandment, thou shalt not commit adultery, Bathsheba. The eighth commandment, thou shalt not steal. He stole Uriah's wife. The ninth commandment, you shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. He lied to Uriah. He brought Uriah home from the battlefield and tried to get him to go home and lie with his wife so it would look like it was his child. And Uriah was of such integrity that, and such a mighty soldier that he wouldn't do that. He said, no, my Lord Joab is on the battlefield and the rest of the armies of Israel, the armies of the Lord are fighting. Why? How could I ever go home and comfort myself by doing such a thing? And so he slept with the king's servants rather than going home. David lied to him. David was lying to all Israel, making them, or trying to make them, believe that Uriah died accidentally in battle. And the 10th commandment, thou shalt not covet. And the word says, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife. So he's broken all 10 of the great commandments, and he's broken the 11th commandment as well. Thou shalt not get caught. That brings us to verse 1. Then the Lord sent Nathan to David. And here's the confrontation now, and Nathan does this in a very powerful way through a parable. And he came to him and said to him, there were two men in one city. The city would be Jerusalem. One was rich, that would be David. The other poor, Uriah. The rich man had exceedingly many flocks and herds. Many wives had David. Was it right? No. But the poor man had nothing except one little ewe lamb, Bathsheba, which he had bought and nourished, and it grew up together with him and with his children. It ate of his own food and drank from his own cup and lay in his bosom, and it was like a daughter to him. And a traveler came to the rich man, to David, and the traveler was Mr. Lusty Eyes, who refused, and the rich man refused to take from his own flock and from his own herd to prepare one for the wayfaring man who had come to him. But he took the poor man's lamb and prepared it for the man who had come to him. End of parable. And as David hears this parable, he is just fired up about it because of the injustice of it and the greed of this rich man. How could he do such a thing? And David responds in verse 5, David's anger was greatly aroused against the man, and he said to Nathan, "As the Lord lives," that's a way of taking an oath, "I swear by the Lord, the man who has done this shall surely die." And probably the ESV translates it more accurately, "The man who's done this deserves to die." But the law of God doesn't serve that kind of penalty for stealing a lamb from a flock. So David goes on to say that the devil will be punished, the scoundrel will be punished to the full extent of the law of God. And here it is: "He shall restore fourfold for the lamb, because he did this thing and because he had no pity." The law of Moses stated that if you stole your neighbor's ox or goat or lamb or whatever, you were to restore fourfold to him. The penalty, however, for murder or death, or murder or adultery, was death. David deserved to die by the law of God. Then Nathan said to David, "You are the man. You are the villain. You're the monster, David, in this story. And thus says the Lord God to you, I anointed you king over Israel, and I delivered you from the hand of Saul. I gave you your master's house and your master's wives into your keeping." Not that David would marry or take those wives to himself, but that it's a way of saying that everything that belonged to Saul now is under David's control. All of Saul's land, all of his possessions. "And I gave to you the house of Israel and Judah and all. And if that had been too little, I also would have given you much more, David. Why have you despised the commandment of the Lord to do evil in his sight? You have killed Uriah the Hittite." Here's the exposure of the sin now. "With the sword, you have taken his wife to be your wife, and have killed him with the sword of the people of Ammon. And according to the law of God, which David knows well, he deserves double death." So what will the consequences be for David? He's waiting now to hear what the Lord has to say to him. Will he die? The consequences in verses 10 through 12 begin this way. "Now therefore, the sword shall never depart from your house, because you have despised me, and you have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your wife." The sword will never depart from your house, David. Do you know that four of David's sons died? This child that has been born to Bathsheba, David's child, will die. Then three other sons will die. Absalom will kill Amnon. And Absalom will also try to kill David. He will try to usurp the kingdom and kill his own father. But Joab will kill Absalom. And then later on, Solomon, the youngest of David's sons, will kill the remaining oldest son, Adonijah. The sword will not depart from your house. David's hellish deed reaped a miserable harvest in his own house. His lustful behavior hatched devastating moral consequences in his home. Not just murder, but all kinds of immorality. The oldest son, Amnon, will rape his stepsister Tamar, the sister of Absalom. And thus Absalom eventually will kill Amnon. Absalom himself will lie with his father's concubines before all Israel on the rooftop of David's palace. Verse 11, "Thus says the Lord, behold, I will raise up adversity against you from your own house, David." He doesn't know yet which son will do these things, but this is what the Lord has said. "And I will take your wives before your eyes and give them to your neighbor." He doesn't know it's going to be his own son. "And he shall lie with your wives in the sight of this son. For you did it secretly, but I will do this thing before all Israel," before the son. When we get to 2 Samuel chapter 16, we'll see these words fulfilled. This is what God does to the man or woman who sins secretly and tries to conceal it. Eventually, if there is not repentance, God will expose that sin publicly. Think back to Joshua chapter 7, the sin of Achan. Before Israel went in to conquer Jericho, the Lord said, "Don't take any spoil. It is the whole city and everything in it is to be utterly destroyed, except for Rahab and her family." But when the armies go in and conquer Jericho, Achan sees a beautiful Babylonian garment and a wedge of gold and 30 shekels of silver, 30 or 50, and he takes those and he sneaks them back to his own tent and buries them under the floor of his tent. And God would expose that sin with calamitous consequences for Israel. The next battle that they went out and fought against the little city of Ai, they were defeated. Israelites died because of Achan's sin. And when they pleaded before the Lord, "What's going on, God? Why does this happen?" The Lord said, "Because there's sin in the camp," and eventually exposes Achan as the sinner. And what did they do to Achan? Take him down into a valley. He, all his family, all his flocks and herds, whatever he owned, he was stoned to death by Israel. They were burned with fire, and a great heap was mound up over them as a sign and a warning to the rest of Israel. It was called the Valley of Achor, the Valley of Trouble. And that's what hidden sin brings to you, to a family, to a church. It brings trouble. God has been very patient with David. He has waited a whole year for David to repent, and yet he has not. He's hardened his heart. He thinks he's gotten away with it. And now it's time for extreme measures, divine measures. I wonder today if there's something that you have done or that you are doing that is in secret, that you're trying to hide under the tent. That maybe you're trying to live by that 11th commandment, "Thou shalt not get caught." Something that you're bowing down to, a secret idol perhaps. Look what happened to David. Look what happened to Achan. Is this what you want? Eventually there will be public exposure. There will be scandal if there's not repentance. You are risking calamitous consequences for yourself and your family. Is it worth all that? And I wonder today, is God saying to anyone here, "You are the man, you are the woman, you are the boy, you are the girl that is sinning against me"? How will you respond to this confrontation if that is the case today? If God is speaking to your heart today about something in your life that you've not repented of, how will you respond? Let's look at the confession of David in verse 13 here. This is the only right way to respond. So David said to Nathan, "I have sinned against the Lord." There's no defense made. There's no excuses given. David says, "I am guilty." And I think when he uttered those words, there was relief that came to him. I've seen this over and over throughout the years, that when somebody has been hiding a secret sin and it's finally exposed and they finally admit to it and own it, that it's like a weight lifted off their shoulder. They know there's going to be consequences, but there's no more hiding, there's no more concealing, there's no more lying, there's no more shiftiness, no more being a hypocrite. The remedy is confession. So David said to Nathan, "I have sinned against the Lord." And Nathan said to David, "The Lord has also put away your sin and you shall not die." When David uttered those words, he is probably expecting the death sentence. But God says, I've put away your sin. I've covered it. I've cleansed you, David. You will not die. God is merciful to David. And so also is he with us when we confess and repent. What does it mean to give a godly confession? It means that you own your guilt, first of all, as David did. Secondly, it means that you then turn from your sin. You don't continue in it. You do what we were talking about a couple of chapters ago. You plow up the fallow ground, the weeds of sin in your heart. You pluck out the lusty eye. You put to death what Paul says in Colossians 3, fornication, uncleanness, passions, evil desires, and covetousness. You put off what he also says, anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy language out of your mouth. Do not lie to one another, and on. You put those things off. You're brutal with the sin in your life. You do godly violence against it, like Elijah did to the prophets of Baal. After he had defeated them on Mount Carmel, he took them down to the brook Kishon, 400 of them. And he said, don't let one of them escape. And every one of them were slain there by Elijah. Don't let any sin escape. Be brutal with it. Slay it. Kill it. Confess it. Confession is owning it. Confession is turning from it, killing it. And thirdly, confession is accepting the consequences of your behavior without complaint. A little boy is caught stealing $10 from his sister, and he's confronted by his parents. Did you do this? Yes, I did it. I'm sorry. I won't do it again. Here's the $10. Well, that's fine, son. Yes, you're going to give back the $10, but you're also going to give back $40. You're going to restore fourfold to her. What? That's not fair. That's not just. No, that's not repentance. Repentance is, if I've truly confessed it and turned from it, then God, I'm willing to accept whatever consequences you bring into my life as a result. And there will be consequences. David accepted God's discipline. Verse 15, then Nathan departed to his house, and the Lord struck the child that Uriah's wife bore to David, and it became ill. David therefore pleaded with God for the child, and David fasted and went in and lay all night on the ground. He laid on the ground for a solid week. He fasted, he prayed, he pleaded with God. He's repenting of his sin and his guilt, confessing, and the Lord is restoring his fellowship with David. But when the child finally dies, what did David do? The scripture says he accepted the will of God. He got up, washed himself, and went to the temple, and he worshiped the Lord. Verse 20, so David arose from the ground, washed and anointed himself, and changed his clothes, and went into the house of the Lord and worshiped. And his servants, he went back home and had food set before him. He hasn't eaten for a week, and his servants are saying, why are you doing this, David? Why are you not fasting now that the child has died? That would seem to be the appropriate thing. And David's response in verse 23, but now he's dead. Why should I fast? Can I bring him back again? I shall go to him, but he shall not return to me. This is the go-to verse in the Bible to comfort parents who've lost a child, a baby, or a little one before the age of understanding. This verse could simply mean that David is saying, the child will not come back to life and not come back to me, but I will join him in the grave. But these words seem to bring comfort to David. And David is comforted by this truth. And would that be the case if it only meant that, yeah, one day I'm going to die and be in the grave? I truly believe that David is saying, one day I will be with him in heaven. Look at the comfort of God in verses 24 and 25. God is not all rod, is he? He's staff also. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Then David comforted Bathsheba, his wife. He confessed his sin to her. I have a hunch that he even lied to Bathsheba, that she has no idea that David's responsible for Uriah's death, that he was a hero, a fallen hero on the battlefield. That would be like him, to take chances and to die with valor and honor. But now David has to confess, that may be true, Bathsheba, but he died at my hand. I was responsible. This is what I did. Please, please forgive me. So there has to be confession to her, truth given to her, and reconciliation with her. And then he went into her and lay with her. So she bore a son. So by the time Solomon is born, he's 50 years old. This may be his last son, I don't know. And he called his name Solomon, meaning peaceful. Why did he call him peaceful? Well, because he's been restored to the Lord. He's confessed his sin. The burden has been lifted. And yes, there's consequences, but that only means God loves me. He's disciplining me. So now there is peace between him and the Lord, and he and Bathsheba. Now the Lord loved him, and he sent word by the hand of Nathan the prophet. And picture Nathan coming into the throne room again, and David is thinking, uh-oh, is this child going to die also? Are there further consequences here with this child? And Nathan says, no, David, God has sent me to tell you that he loves this son. And so David called his name Jedidiah because of the Lord. Jedidiah means loved by the Lord. Dean has chosen a closing song today that will be very appropriate to this theme and to this name. How sweet it is to be loved by Jesus. He chose the songs before I ever had the sermon started, so it's a divine coincidence, but it's very appropriate to this chapter, loved by the Lord. What grace and love here, because one day this Solomon, this peaceful, is going to sit on the throne of Israel. And you would expect that he would be the last one to ascend to his father's throne. He is the least of all his brothers. He is the youngest, not the oldest. He is the child of Bathsheba, the child of this scandal in David's life. And what grace and love that God is one day going to put him on the throne. All the cards are stacked against him. And yet, like Rahab, the harlot of Jericho, and like Ruth, the Moabitess, these two Gentile women will be chosen to be in the royal line of the future Messiah, because God is gracious and God is merciful. And likewise, he is with us. There is grace and mercy for fallen, repentant saints. You can have the hope of a blessed, peaceful future because God extends loving grace to repentant, fallen saints. I just urge you, don't wait a year. Don't wait a month. Don't wait a week. If there is sin in your life, repent, confess it. Don't wait until you've got spiritual frostbite. Don't wait until your prayer life is dead and the Bible is silent and your worship is empty. Because meanwhile, as you are waiting, damage is being done not only to you, but potentially to your family, your loved ones, your church. You will face lifelong consequences as David did. But when you repent, you will thank God for that, knowing that he disciplines those he loves, those who are his children. So let's look at now, in conclusion, the conquest of Rabbah, verses 26 through 30. The chapter ends with Joab's conquering this royal city of the Ammonites. He has been at war with them for a year. because way back when David committed adultery, this is who Joab was fighting against. They were out conquering the people of Ammon. Remember what the king of Ammon did to David's ambassadors? When his father died, David sent his ambassadors to go and give condolences and offer comfort. And when they get there, the son of that dead king decides, no, they're here to spy on us. And so he has half of their beards shaved off and their clothes cut off at the buttock. He shames them, and this is a declaration of war. So David has been at it now, and Joab, for a year. And Joab now calls David to come to the capital city for the final surge. Verse 29. So David gathered all the people together and went to Rabbah and fought against it and took it. And then he took their king's crown from his head. He was a very wealthy king. The crown weighed a talent of gold, 75 pounds. Can you imagine two bowling balls on top of your head? You wouldn't wear that crown very long, I would imagine. It's probably something you'd keep in a, like the crown jewels of England, in some kind of trophy case. But David, anyway, had that crown, and it was put on his head. Also, he brought out the spoil of the city with great abundance, and he brought out the people who were in it and put them to work with saws and iron picks and iron axes and made them cross over to the brickworks. So he did to all the cities of the people of Ammon. And then David and all the people returned to Jerusalem. And David is once again enjoying the blessings and the victories of God. So here are three concluding lessons very quickly. Number one, if a man after God's own heart like David could sin and fall so grievously, then none of us is immune to falling. Not one of us. And if you think you get to a place where you're so spiritual and holy that you couldn't fall, then you're about to fall. You're the next target. Never take that for granted. And that's why Proverbs 4:23 says, guard your heart, keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it flow the issues of life, out of it flow the springs of life. Guard your heart. Had David plowed up the soil of adultery, had he plucked out the eye of lust, had he put to death evil passion, had he put off those immoral behaviors, we wouldn't be reading these things today. We wouldn't have chapters in 11 and 12 covering the sins of David as this great fall shares them. But they are here for our warning and our admonition. Secondly, if we do fall as believers, there is grace and mercy for restoration. There's great hope we take from this chapter. It's all conditional on what? Confess the sin, repent of the sin, turn from the sin, and own the consequences. Make amends to anybody that you've offended in the process. 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins to Him, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Thirdly and finally, there may be lifelong consequences for your sins. Galatians 6:7 says, do not be deceived. God isn't mocked. Whatever you sow, that's what you will reap. That's a spiritual law, the spiritual law of the harvest. So if you have sown seeds of destruction, if you're reaping calamitous consequences, accept them wholeheartedly from the Lord as proof of your repentance. If you don't accept them, then you really need to question, am I really repentant? Am I really even saved? Are you still trying to get away with it? Thank God for His mercy, that He loves you and disciplines you. And as you do so, you will know that you are greatly loved and that you are God's Jedediah. Lord, we thank You for this great chapter in Your Word again today. It ministers hope to us and instruction and how to live and why it is important to live a godly life. And we pray for grace to be poured out upon your church, Lord, that we would truly honor you by putting to death any unrepentant sin in our lives, turning from it, Lord, and giving glory to you by being conformed to the likeness of Jesus. I pray for anyone today here present with us or anyone listening to this service that you would give them that power, that conviction to turn and be delivered and to give you praise and glory and to rejoice and know that they are greatly loved by you to be God's Jedediahs. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As we were rehearsing this morning, the unanimous consensus was, it wasn't the general consensus, it was the unanimous consensus that we all really miss hearing you sing back to us. Amen. So with that being said, we really like you to make an effort to sing this last song with us. It's a new song I'm going to teach you. It only has 12 words to the chorus. We'll sing the chorus through a couple times. You can listen to Sherry sing the verse and then join us with the chorus. And it goes like this. How sweet it is. How sweet it is. How sweet it is to be loved by Jesus. How sweet it is. How sweet it is. How sweet it is to be loved by you. Join us, please.
How sweet it is. How sweet it is. How sweet it is to be loved by Jesus.
You're not singing David Nelson.
How sweet it is. How sweet it is. How sweet it is to be stories ever told, all the songs the world could hold, not a single one comes close to tell you what's inside my soul. How sweet it is. How sweet it is, how sweet it is.
sweet it is, how sweet it is, how sweet it is to be loved by you.
With a benediction, we'll continue in Hebrews and then end with the final benediction in Hebrews. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good, that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.
And it goes like this. How sweet it is. How sweet it is. How sweet it is to be loved by Jesus. How sweet it is. How sweet it is. How sweet it is to be loved by you. Join us, please.
How sweet it is. How sweet it is. Sweet it is to be loved by Jesus.
You're not singing David Nelson.
How sweet it is. How sweet it is. How sweet it is to be loved by you.
All the stories ever told, all the songs the world could hold, a single one comes close to tell you what's inside my soul.
How sweet it is. How sweet it is. How sweet it is to be loved by Jesus. How sweet it is. How sweet.
How sweet it is.
sweet.